Okay, g'day all and welcome to another video. So the topic of today is going to be split into two videos, and we'll do one today and another one tomorrow. And the topic that we're looking at is caches. So the topic of today will be an introduction to set associative caches, just so that we understand what all of the numbers mean when we talk about caches on CPUs. And the topic for tomorrow, which I'll put a link to up above when the video is uploaded, the topic of tomorrow will be a discussion, a comparison, and a commentary on real hardware. Yeah, we're going to talk about Intel and AMD hardware. We're going to compare some of the older CPUs all the way up to the latest Ryzens and i9s. If you enjoy these videos, please consider becoming a Patreon of the channel. Yeah, I'll put a link up above for the Patreon and one down below in the video description. It really does help me make more videos. All right, thank you. Okay, first of all, what is a cache? Well, a cache is just a small local area of memory that's designed to hold copies of data nearby for quick access. So CPU caches are designed to store data from system memory, or RAM, and the idea is that then the CPU can process the data without actually having to make continuous requests to RAM, and this reduces RAM traffic and it greatly speeds up our programs. So CPU caches are much faster than RAM, and just as an indication, it takes something like 100 or maybe 200 cycles to complete a RAM request. Whereas it might only take, say, 5 cycles to access data from the cache. Okay, so modern consumer CPUs, we're talking AMD and Intel CPUs here, they generally include 3 levels of cache, and they're labeled L1, L2, and L3. So the L there is just short for level. Now, L1 is the smallest but the fastest cache, L2 is medium-sized and medium speed, and L3 is the largest but the slowest cache. And the other thing is all 3 of these caches in a modern AMD or Intel CPU are also what's called set associative caches. A set associative cache is broken into sets, and each set can contain some specified number of elements called the associativity of the cache. So we could talk about a 4-way set associative cache, and that would mean that the cache has sets which store up to 4 elements. Or we could say an 8-way set associative cache, and that would be a cache where the sets contain 8 elements each. So a set associative cache is really just a cache that's split into sets. Now the elements that the sets hold are actually called cache lines, or sometimes cache blocks. And it's a really interesting point and a very, very important point. The CPU actually never reads and writes to its caches, or indeed RAM, in bytes. It always reads and writes in cache lines. Yeah, so it'll never write, say, a single integer or a single float. It always updates the entire cache line. And in AMD and Intel CPUs, these cache lines are actually 64 bytes wide. So if you request a single little variable at some address, then the CPU is actually going to request the entire 64-byte line that the variable belongs to. And this happens to mean that any address where the lowest hex digits are 00, 40, 80, or C0, any of those addresses are actually the start of a cache line. So the CPU does this to take advantage of access patterns in RAM. It's a funny thing, but if we access a particular byte in RAM, then just because of the patterns that we use in programming, there's a very high chance that we're also going to use one of the surrounding bytes. Okay, so a set associative cache is split into sets, and the sets contain cache lines. Okay, so this is an example of a very small fictional machine, just so that we can get an idea of exactly how these set associative caches function. So we have RAM up the top. Now that's system memory, and for this little machine there's actually 256 bytes of RAM. So the RAM in our little machine just here can be addressed with a single byte, or 8 bits. 2 hex digits, in other words, and we'll use the low hex digit to specify the column and the high hex digit to specify the row. Yeah, so I've drawn it as a grid just here, but this is actually flat. This is just a single dimensional array, just like normal flat RAM in x64. So if you want to address RAM just here, we could say something like, well, the hex digits, say 5, 3 would reference this little 6 just here. Yeah, so 3 being the low digit, we just look along the column there and look up the row, number 5. Or we could do hex digit number, A1? Yeah, that would be the 3 just there. All right, and down below, I've drawn a little set associative cache. So you can see in this particular illustration that there's actually four sets, but let's just pretend that we can't see that there's four sets for a moment, and we'll just spend a little moment to discuss how to figure out how many sets there are from the cache size and the associativity. Okay, so often the information that you're given will be the total size of the cache, which is 32 bytes. You'll be given the associativity, which is two-way, set associative, and you'll also be told the size of the cache lines. Our fictional little machine just here will say that the cache lines are 4 bytes each. Okay, let's work out how many sets there are. Well, if the sets contain 2 cache lines each, since it's a two-way set associative cache, and if each cache line is 4 bytes wide, then that means that each set contains 2 times 4 bytes, or 8 bytes, in other words. And if the total cache is 32 bytes, and each set is 8 bytes, then the total number of sets must be 32 divided by 8. In other words, there are 4 sets. Okay, let's look at how addressing works. So addresses are read in 3 sections. We've got the offset, the index, and the tag. And the offset is the lowest bits. Now that references the exact byte from a line that the CPU might be interested in reading or changing. The index is actually the set index. And for us, that will be 0, 1, 2, or 3 for our little cache, since we have 4 sets. And the remaining bits in the address are read as the tag. And the tag is just used to uniquely identify lines when they're stored in the cache. Okay, so we have 8-bit addresses for our little cache just here. Let's compute the number of bits in each of the sections of the address. So we'll start with the offset, the lowest bits. So for our cache, cache lines are 4 bytes wide, and that means that the offset is 2 bits. Log base 2 of the cache line size equals 2. In other words, we'd need 2 bits to accurately specify any one of the bytes from our cache lines. So that means that the lowest 2 bits of our addresses will be the offset bits. Next is the index. So the index specifies the set that a cache line belongs to. So there's 4 sets in our cache, so there's going to be 2 index bits in our addresses. So once again, that's just the log base 2 of the number of sets. Yeah, so we've got 4 sets in this instance, so log base 2 of 4 gives you 2. In other words, you'd need 2 bits to accurately specify any one of our 4 sets. So the offset in our addresses will be the low 2 bits, and the set index will be the next lowest 2 bits. And that leaves the 4 upper bits to be the tag. Okay, so looking at our little diagram just here, we can actually make it a little bit easier to see. So we know that every group of 4 bytes in our RAM will belong to a cache line. And what we could do is just color the cache lines, red, green, blue, and yellow, and also color our sets. That way we can see for any cache line in RAM, which set it will end up in if we read it. Yeah, should just make things easier to see. Okay, so let's have a look at what happens when the CPU actually requests some data from RAM. So let's say that the CPU requests the byte at address 0x73. So that's hexadecimal 73, number 115 in decimal. So the first thing that the CPU's got to do is check if the byte is already in its cache, because the CPU doesn't want to go all the way to RAM if the byte is already in its cache. Now, our cache happens to be empty at the moment, but let's just go through the motion so that we know how to do this. So the address 0x73 will be read as 3 sections, the offset, the index, and the tag. Now, if we convert the number 0x73 to binary, what we get is 0111 0011. Now, the lowest 2 bits of that number will be the offset, the next 2 bits will be the set index, and the top 4 bits are the tag. So that'll make our offset 11, our set index would be 00, and the top 4 bits, 0111, will be our tag. So what this means is that if the byte 0x73 is in the cache, then it's going to be in set 00, or the first set, in other words. So the CPU would look at the first set, and it would see that the set is empty, and it would determine that what it needs to do is read the cache line from RAM. And we have what's called a cache miss. So the CPU would then send the request for the cache line containing the byte 0x73 to RAM, and RAM would return the cache line 9055. So the way that we've drawn RAM just here, 9 is the lowest byte of the cache line, then the 0, and then the 2 fives at the top. So RAM is going to return the cache line 9055 to the CPU, and the CPU is going to store that in its cache just in case it needs any of those bytes later. Now the set that this line belongs to is set 00, or the first set, but when the CPU saves the line to the cache, it also records the tag bits, because it will need to know exactly which line this is later. Now this is the first element in set 0, so the tag bits 0111 will be written here, and the data we read will be written here. And the line is stored. So the cache doesn't know or care what the CPU is doing with the 5. The CPU is going to store the 5 in a register or do some computation with it or whatever. The cache doesn't know anything about that. All the cache does is store the cache line along with its tag. So notice that the offset bits were never stored in the cache. The offset bits are just used by the CPU to look up one of the bytes in the cache line, like the 5 that it just requested. Okay, so that was a cache miss. Let's have a look at what happens when there's a cache hit. So let's see what happens if the CPU reads address 0x70. So first of all, the CPU wants to check its cache to see if this memory is already there. So what we got to do is convert the address 0x70 to binary, and we get 0111000. So once again here, the lowest two bits are the offset of the requested byte, that's 00, and the next two bits are going to be the set index, that's 00 also, or in other words, the first set, and the top bits are the tag, so 0111. So what the CPU knows from this is that if the line is in its cache, then it's going to be in set 0. So what it's going to do, it's going to look in set 0 and see that there's actually data cached there. So what it's got to do now is check if the tag bits match in order to know if the line in the cache is actually the one that it's looking for. So the tag bits in the cache are 0111, which is an exact match for the tag of the address that it's looking for. Yeah, so the tag bits of the address it's looking for are 0111 also. Okay, so the CPU knows after comparing these two tag bits that this is the line that it's looking for. So what we've got here is called a cache hit. Okay, so the CPU wants byte 00 from this line. That's the offset bits from the address that it's looking up. And that's the byte 9 just here in our little cache line. So the CPU is just going to read the 9 from the cache and continue on its way. So notice that it hasn't sent any requests to RAM at all this time, and in so doing, in getting the data from its cache, this operation is going to be performed much, much faster. Okay, so we've seen a cache miss and we've seen a cache hit. Let's have a look at a cache eviction. So let's fast forward a little bit and say that our CPU has been executing for a little while and the entire cache is full of cache lines. So now the CPU wants to read the byte at address EA. Once again, it prefers to get this from its cache rather than RAM if it can. So let's convert the number to binary to see which set the byte actually belongs to. EA in binary is 11101010. So the low two bits there are the offset, that's 10. The next two bits are the set index, which is also 10. That means set number 2. So if the byte at address EA is in the cache, then it's going to be in set number 2. Well, if we have a bit of a look at set number 2, there's two data elements in set number 2. The CPU is going to have to compare the tag bits from the address that it's looking for with the tag bits from both of the lines in the set to see if any of them match. Well, the tag bits from the first line in the set are 1100, so that's not a match. And the tag bits from the second line in the set, the right-hand one here, are 0100, so that's not a match either. Okay, so the CPU knows that the line it's looking for is not in its cache. It's going to have to get this from RAM. So it's going to request the line containing the byte EA from RAM, and RAM is going to respond with the data 1871. So the CPU is actually looking for the number 7 in that little cache line, so it can go off and do whatever computation it has to do with that. But now it wants to cache the line 1871 that it just read from RAM, just in case it needs those bytes later. So the trouble is that the set is already full. So in order to make room for this new cache line, the CPU has to evict one of the existing lines from the set. And the rules that a CPU uses to choose which line to evict and what happens to the line after it's evicted are all part of a procedure that's called the eviction policy. Often the oldest line in the cache will be evicted. This is called the least recently used cache line. So in our little diagram here, the older cache line might be the right-hand one. The CPU will evict the line 4545 from its cache, possibly writing it back to RAM if there's been some change that it has to record. And then what it's going to do is move the line 9635 to the right position, since that's now the older of the two cache lines, and it's going to record the new line, recording the tag bits here and the data here. And that, my friends, is pretty much how a set associative cache works. Yeah, just an illustration of a very small machine here. Yeah, so real CPUs work pretty much the same. It's just instead of having like 256 bytes in RAM, they've got like 16 gigabytes. And instead of being, you know, four-way set associative, they'll be 64-way and that sort of thing. Yeah, but same idea, just larger numbers that they work on. So this is really, really important stuff, because if we understand how a set associative cache works, then we can often make sure that the data that we need is actually in the cache when we need it. And it can speed up programs like twice as fast or 10 times as fast. I mean, the effect of properly employing caches is it's really, really worth doing. Anyway, that was just a little introduction to set associative caches.